Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Today is officially the first day of spring. Digging that. Tired of this cold, wet weather. Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world on the internet, thanks to the marvel of technology. I am coming at you live from my little guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard. You're listening to Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Enfoldment and Reinforcement. Strapping all ye brother and sister astronauts as we launch for inner space. Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern time, you can find me here in the captain's chair conducting all the affairs of the heart. The music you hear before every Center of Light broadcast is my spiritual group, Lavender Soul. If you want to find out more about Lavender Soul, which consists of myself and members of the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. Talk about powerful musicians. Wow. Contact me at keithanthonyblanchard@gmail.com and say, hey, Keith, I'm interested in more information about Lavender Soul. I'd be more than happy to send you in that direction. Put some information and some music in your experience. And we consider this healing music of the universe, because when Bernard II and I sit down and write music, something just begins to happen. The music just effortlessly pours out, and then we go through the process of writing the songs and recording them layer after layer until we come up with this beautiful product called Lavender Soul. Still have not heard anything from Swamiji Viswayogi yet about coming back to Memphis. I did have a couple of sleep experiences with him, and he's reaching to me to make contact, and somehow I'm not cognitive enough during my sleep experience to be aware. But I know he's there because I see him for a small amount of time, and then, of course, sometimes I just go into another experience altogether. Still working on my alien-human hybrid friend, Mr. Nucleus 8. Who is head of security for this quadrant of our galaxy. He's 4,740 years old, I believe. I had the opportunity to hang out with this cat for about 4 years, and he's done the most amazing things to me, through me, and right in front of my face that you wouldn't believe me as I'm telling you that these things did occur. If you're out and about on the internet, you're doing some surfing, why not go to centeroflightradio.com, check out the brand new website, click on that red Ferrari down at the bottom of the open page. It will take you to RPM, my RPM program, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. This is my lifelong work now. I am absolutely confident that if you purchase this program and put it into your life, you will expand. This is not about fixing you because you're broken. This is about helping you get to deeper and greater degrees of bliss that you desire, that you deserve. Of course, we all do. But I'm 100% confident that this program will help you achieve an expanded life and lots more bliss. You can bet on that. If you want to call into the show today, dial 888-919-2355, 888-919-2355 to speak to myself or my guests. Let me give you a couple announcements about some of the services I'll do. Oh, heads up, in the very near future, I'm going to be doing some traveling around the Mid-South area. Who knows, it may go even further, but I'm going to be doing a speaking tour. I can do life-changing presentations on spirituality, divine incarnations, the subject of extraterrestrials, my own personal experiences with that, but also my time with, as I mentioned a minute ago, Nucleus 8. And I, some of the things that I've been discovering recently is pretty powerful. I've been looking at the Cosmic Disclosure series, and I'm just wild by some of the things I'm finding out. Let's see, spiritual readings. I do spiritual readings. People are contacting me for spiritual readings. I don't like doing readings per se, even though there's intuition involved. I guess you can call it readings, but the word psychic is just not my gig. It's too heavy of a connotation for me, and I don't like monkeying with people's minds, their lives, professing that I know more about them than they do. But instead, I prefer getting them to a space of explosive clarity where they can make all the choices about the things they would like to see in their life versus getting it from me and my opinions of what I think they would possibly want. For those who are interested, this Thursday night at 8 o'clock Central Time, if you go to facebook.com/KeithAnthonyBlanchard, look on my wall. If you get to my wall at 8 o'clock and you don't see a live feed, refresh the page a few times until you see it there and it'll stick for you. Come in the room. We're going to be doing a burst of light live feed on, wow, here we go. Take me to your leader. ETs and why they are here. It's going to last about an hour. or so. Pretty powerful stuff from all the information I've gleaned through my research. And everyone who knows me knows that when I find something and I start chasing it into the rabbit hole, I will take it in there as far as possible. And if I have to go back out the rabbit hole and get a shovel and bring it back in, I will dig even a little bit further. You can bet on that. That's the level of devotion and dedication I have to something that I'm trying to find more about that can expand not only myself, but anybody who may want to receive such information from me. Life coaching. I do life coaching. Again, it's about giving you guidance so you can get explosive clarity to make the decisions about what it is you want to bring into your experience. Do you have any dark entities in your house, spiritual squatters? If you do, I am your guy, and I will be with you in it all the way. I will not hand you the information and just take off. I know how troublesome it can be. I've helped quite a few people with the arsenal of information I have that will help raise the vibration of you, your house, your home, your family unit, and these ghosts, these bad people, whatever they are, your vibration will elevate and they will disappear just as quickly as they came. And I guarantee you that the info I hand you will help you do that. I will be giving you certain mantras. I will be giving you certain pictures of holy men from around the world that I absolutely know will change the vibration of your house. So that's really, really cool. I've seen this work repeatedly. Let me give you a little bit of insight on my guest today, because it's now time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Today on Center of Light Radio, we have Adona. And let me give you a bio on her first, because she's going to join us on the back half of the show at the bottom of the hour. Adona is a highly gifted telepath since age 12, when her maternal grandmother, Hester, passed on. Adona says throughout the course of her life, she has seen, felt, experienced, and continues to this day many interdimensional and intergalactic communications. Being a small spiritual communicator, Adona says that after now speaking in public for many years, she is now rededicated to doing her mission here on Earth, reassuring humanity, encouraging, and giving them hope for their future here on Earth and in, quote, the heavens. Let me tell you about my guest who's coming on shortly, Mr. Tolec. Tolec is a human representative of the Andromeda Council, an intergalactic, interstellar and interdimensional governance and development body of aligned, benevolent star system and planets of sentient, intelligent life for worlds in both the Milky Way and Andromeda galaxies. This organization has 12 senior member star systems, inclusive of their many home worlds and over 140 additional member planets. In deep space, this governance body is known by its ambassadors and diplomats as the Galactic Council. And you can find more about my guest, Adona, at www.starancestry.com. And for Tolec, who is now about to come on the air, at www.andromedacouncil.com. Welcome to Center of Light, Tolec.
Keith, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
Hey, my friend, I'm glad you were here. happy spring to you, sir.
Spring. Yeah. Bulbs are popping up. It's a sunny day and birds are tweeting. So yeah, that's a good sign of spring.
Loving it. I'm so excited about this new season, Tolec, because I'm just tired of the cold. I can't do the cold. My producer and I have dialogue often about where he lives in Chicago. And every time I think of the word Chicago, I just think, boom.
I worked in Chicago back in the mid-80s. And we were there. I was part of an installation support team for a healthcare software concern. And in the mid-80s, I don't know about the 90s, but when we were there in the mid-80s, there were icicles 20, 25 feet long hanging from high-rise buildings in Chicago. You know, the temperature was like minus five, minus seven, 17 degrees, wind blowing. And I grew up in the Northeast, but I was like, you people are crazy. I'd never live here full time. So, no thanks.
So, Tolec,
wonderful people in the Midwest. Absolutely.
How do we begin this program by just other than outright asking you, how did you get plugged into such a cosmic system?
You know, this is actually a really good place to start. And before I reveal to your listeners what I've experienced and how long it's been going on, I want to respect your time for this evening. So do we have an hour show or is this a 2-hour show that we're doing?
This is a 1-hour show.
It's a 1-hour show. Okay. Then I'll make my answers, brief accordingly. back in the late summer of 1993, I was contacted by the man that I know today as the commander of Primary Andromeda Council Biosphere. It was 3:30, quarter four in the morning a.m. I had recently relocated to Tucson from the Northeast. And just like you and I are speaking now, we're using the internet as a communication device. I could hear this man's voice clearly. And he said to me, "Hey, you got to get up." Now, keep in mind, I was sleeping. I said, "You got to get up. You got to get dressed. I need you to come meet me down off of I-10 toward I-19. It's the San Javier exit." So to make a long story short, got up, got dressed, went to the bathroom, hit the road, and I followed his instructions, got off the highway, went through the desert, and found this craft. And just as he described, it was 37 feet in diameter, silver. And I had traded in my car from the Northeast, which was like black leather loaded, and I was driving a Bronco at the time. Four-wheel drive kind of thing. So I'm taking this road, and I stopped the Bronco, and I see the craft sitting there. He's standing outside. And I hopped out of my own vehicle, and I was excited to see him again. At some level, I not only recognized him physically, but I recognized the sound of his voice. You know, when your buddies, and you get out of school, and you've been out for 20 years or whatever the time frame is, it can be 2 weeks, 2 years, or 13 or 14 years, and doesn't matter. You recognize the sound of that guy's voice. You recognize your friend's face.
Absolutely.
Same thing with this gentleman. I recognize his face. I recognize his voice. And he basically looked at me and said, "Come on, we got to go. It's going to be daylight soon. I don't necessarily want a bunch of people going to work in Tucson to see my craft sitting here." to make a long story short, from that day, over the course of the next week and a half, I traveled with him in his craft, traveling back through time on three separate occasions, and traveling back to the very rural area of Western Kentucky and Virginia. And we observed a family of four, a dad in his mid-30s, a young mother in her late 20s. They had two kids, a boy like 9 or 10, a daughter, three or four years old, blonde hair, cute little girl. During the last trip, as we were observing them in their daily activities, the young daughter went in the barn playing with the animals for a while. She fell asleep. There was a fire. She died of smoke inhalation. And I asked this gentleman, "Geez, out of all the events that you could have showed me, at that moment, my life was my first physical contact with this man on the third trip." But I said, "Why this?" And he said, "There are three primary reasons. One is, if you look back in your own genetic history, you are genetically..." I said, "Okay." He said, "Two, we as higher dimensional beings," he said, "my natural form is..." At that time, they were high level 4D, fourth dimensional. He said, "My natural form is pretty much translucent or transparent. Because we are comprised of light and energy, we don't die. We live for thousands of years and evolve. And we are trying to better understand you and your people and the depth of feeling that you have as an organic people, and what you have, you experience emotionally when a death happens regarding people that you care about." And the third reason was, he told me at that time that there would be a period in our planet's future, actually this time that we're in, where there would be many, many changes on planet Earth. And it would be helpful for them to more closely observe an Earth human, in this case, me, even in times of emotional stress, to see how we would respond so that they can better understand us.
When you say that you visited these people, how was that? Was it a window on the craft opened up and you can view into their life? I mean, to where you were invisible, they cannot see?
Right.
How was that?
Right. We were in his craft. So first of all, to back up for a moment, when we left Earth, I felt the sensation of leaving the ground. I did not feel any sensation of traveling once we got into the immediate space over Earth. I couldn't feel any sensation of travel at all.
What did he look like?
He was tall. He was about 7'4". He had long dark hair, which at that time was pulled in the back of his head. And he would look like what you might consider to be a good-looking Native American.
Was he Andromeda, or was he of the human race, or mixed?
His people are from the planet Dakota. And Dakota is one of four planets of the Taygeta star system in the Pleiades. You know that there are the seven sisters, which are, in fact, seven major star systems. And there are some others. Of the Pleiades. He and his people came from the star system Taygeta. He's from the planet Dakota in that star system. And was he human? Yes. Originally, as a matter of fact, many, 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 many years before, his people were 3D organic, and they had evolved as well. Human, yes. Without a doubt, human. Looked human, spoke my language. By the way, when he spoke to me, it was telepathic. It was not through his mouth.
I heard someone in the recent past tell me that Andromeda was who we are, but from the future. Would that be correct from your time with these people and the information that you've gleaned from this these contacts?
Good question. This question has far more many layers than the time we have to discuss it in depth. But I can tell you this. In the 6.5 years I've been doing this work, I can tell you that categorically I've learned that it's not that we are Earth human organically. It's not only that our soul, or at least the slice of our soul that animates these bodies, is made of higher dimensional fine essence matter, and that typically these souls of ours come from other star systems. But suffice it to say, I've also learned that we are actually multidimensional beings. So are we currently 3D Earth human? Yes. Are we 4D, 5D, 6D, 7D all at the same time? The answer is yes. There are different aspects of our higher dimensional selves experiencing life in other solar systems, in other star systems throughout the cosmos. And the thing that might help you and your listeners to understand this is that once you enter a vibration above 3D, which is of a faster vibratory rate and a higher frequency, time does not exist. So in fact, doing things simultaneously is a reasonable and acceptable assumption. It's because it is possible, because in the higher dimensions, time doesn't exist.
I'm aware of the fact that we lived multidimensionally, gosh knows where and when, right? But I want to make sure that I understand this, that when you say we come from star systems, and being the teacher, a spiritual teacher, and doing all the research that I've done, it's not like, per se, that we, from the other side, as if we were in, quote, heaven, right? And that we choose to incarnate up upon the Earth. It's very much the fact that we could be living on another star system, as you have just described, and have reached a vibration and a level of spiritual consciousness, that while we still reside on said planet, that we are actually able to create and project a body here on Earth. And as to why, I don't know, I'm on that star system. But when I do pass away in this reality, I will likely become conscious and cognitive of the reality from where I project myself. Yes, is that what you're saying?
That's one way to say it. But I'm also saying that due to the nature of the human, what we call the human soul, and due to the nature of how it is able to function, and I've used this analogy before, and it's a pretty good one. Imagine, Keith, that the totality of your human soul is a 24-slice extra-large pizza. Just follow me here. Let's say, for the sake of illustration, that it takes one slice, one piece of that pizza soul to animate this Earth human body. simultaneously, your other 23 slices are out in the cosmos experiencing life in other dimensions, in other star systems. That's what I'm saying. When this Earth human body that each of us uses dies, there are a number of options that we have. One is A, to come back to Earth if we want to and begin a new human life again, a new organic life. And there are other options as well, which include staying in the higher dimensions and go doing other things in other star systems in other vibratory rates higher than this organic one here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Clear answer. Okay, good.
Absolutely. I have a question from the chat room from Don Danny. He says, Billy Myrer says, the Pleiadians he is in contact with claim to be from the parallel dimension. Are these the same people?
No. The people that Billy Myrer has been in contact with are, in fact, from the Taygeta star system, but the planet they are from is Era, E-R-R-A. Of the list of four planets, there's Pyra, Vela, with a V, Dakota, and Era. The people from planet Era are the ones that Billy Myrer has been communicating with.
Let me ask you this. Out of all the reports we hear of all the different alien civilizations that visit Earth, I've never really heard about Andromeda. You hear about the Greys, you hear about the Reptilians, you hear about the Pleiadians and all that. I never really hear about Andromedans coming to Earth. Why is that? Why is that not familiar to my ear that you know, it seems to me that they've come a long time ago and they went back and they may be observing, but that they don't really show up in craft anymore. Tell me a little more about that and why it's not reaching my ear, at least.
Here's a couple of answers. First of all, the Andromeda Council, as it's known on planet Earth, I'm not the only person to have this contact with people from the Andromeda Council. My predecessor is Alex Collier, and still has contact with people from the Andromeda Council. So first of all, in deep space, this council is known by its ambassadors and diplomats as the Galactic Council. It was formed thousands and thousands of years ago by a large group from the Arcturus star system and a number of other smaller councils and another group of three councils. And they brought themselves together for the sake of efficiency. And I think efficiency is the best way to say it. And their values were very, very closely aligned. The people from this Galactic Council, and I just learned this in terms of the overall breach, if you will, the overall way that they function. They're actually a council of councils. In fact, within the Galactic Council, aka Andromeda Council, there are special members and councils representing other star systems, the Sirius star system, the Procyon star system, the Arcturus star system. This Galactic Council is really a council of councils.
Adona just came into the picture, so let's see if we can get Adona on the air. Adona, are you with me, darling?
Hi, how are you all doing? I'm happy to be on the show. I'm happy to be here. I was listening in to y'all's conversation about the star systems. It's kind of interesting how it evolved in terms of humanity want to know, where do they come from? Why they're here? Who are the star families? I started the Star Ancestry back in November 2016, and I did probably, I want to say, over 100 people already. Come to find out that there are Andromedans that y'all have just got through talking about, Pleiadians, Arcturians, the Procyon people. It is amazing to find that majority of these people that volunteered for their service on this planet are highly evolved souls. And the council the Andromeda Council, along with the joint members of the Council of Councils, have all discussed what is the best way that we can do to help humanity awaken, to help them evolve, to help Mother Earth's vibratory rate, the frequency, and bring it all up to where they can join with the galactic community that is already, how should I say that, that is already members of the Galactic Federation, as well as the Andromeda Council. This is the exciting time for the people of Earth. It's basically go back to centuries of feeling like being separated from the heavens, so to speak, as people would call it. It's actually the rejoining of all the star families with the people of Earth. And this is what I have come to discover through my communications with my star people guys that are responsible for the soul essence records, the archival records that they have aboard the biospheres. So this is where I'm at.
So did you ever make contact with others yourself, or is this something through just research that you've done, or is this something you've been having as an experience, be it from a child until present day? I'm just trying to find out a little more about how deeply rooted you are in this experience of star ancestry. Have you been taken aboard craft? Have you had conscious aware experiences of being with others in other places?
Okay, I got your question. Thank you. This has been ongoing since I was about 4 years old. The contact experiences I've had were all very much positive experiences, as well as being taken aboard the crafts. And today, looking back on it, I do remember a lot of, you know, bits and pieces of the meetings that I have attended during those time periods where they have taken me aboard the ship. It's just as real as if you're standing right here.
I absolutely know how real it is, because when I have my nighttime experiences with, quote, others, I become so hyper-conscious, it actually almost dwarfs the level of consciousness that I have when I'm here on this earth in my body. We're at the bottom of the hour. Would you give out your contact information, Adona, so our listening audience can find out more about you and the work that you are doing?
Absolutely. It's Star Ancestry, all small letters. com. You will find the page about the basic and the premium. If people want the basic, just a simple basic information, they can choose that. Or if they want the premium plus the basic, which means they get the whole story of their journey here.
Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always.
So what is some of the work you were doing to help for the humanity's vibration to lift? How do you do that other than just being a presence for such cosmic energy? I mean, do you do presentations? Do you do certain workshops? Do you do meditations? How does that work?
Oh, okay. Right now, I'm in the process of going with Tolec on a speaking tour. And in the speaking tour, of course, there will be question and answer panel sessions during those time periods, as well as availability of workshops wherever it is available in those cities. So I'm just starting out in terms of reaching out to humanity in this capacity.
We do have Tolec back on the air. If something happened, he went into a black hole. And
well said.
<must have. laughs>
Now he's back. So how did you two guys meet? I would like to hear some dialogue or some conversation between you two. In fact, I would like it to be about something that gets you both going. If no one was here and it was just you two in the room and you guys are going to play with the cosmic stuff, how would you guys go about it? I'm just curious to know what you share between you as far as your passion about all of this.
Oh, well, that question has a lot of answers.
And I opened up a major can of worms.
No, not at all. I mean, I wish we had more time, but from my side, and I'll do my best to speak for the both of us, and then, I'll let Adona hop in here. During the course of the last 8 years, where we've been talking a lot, keep in mind that we first met in Tucson in the mid-90s, I believe it was 1995. Lost touch with each other, reconnected again since 2008. To say that we're close is very accurate. To say that we're really good friends is also very accurate. But in the time that Adona has been speaking with her higher dimensional guides, family members, friends, and I have collaboratively been speaking with the people from the Andromeda Council, members, diplomats, the man who's the commander of the primary Andromeda Council biosphere. Adona and I learned that back on the planet Dakota, where our souls first experienced life, she and I on Dakota are actually brother and sister. So look at wow. Look at the 6.5 years worth of work that I've done on the Andromeda Council website and the number of topics that she and I have talked about are self-evident on that website. And it's, it would take hours and hours and hours to address any one of those. But typically when we speak, we're speaking about how would things be handled on a situation-by-situation basis in the higher dimensions? If you're living a higher dimensional life, a more conscious, awake, and aware life, how would we handle certain situations from that perspective, given the fact that we live here on Earth? Adona, go ahead.
What has been my experience is that when Tolec and I get into a very deep conversation, my guys would always present telepathic conversations as well as imagery and movie clips. And so can you imagine it takes, a moment to translate from their thoughts into a focalized words. And I have so much fun with telepathic communications because lip is there. And two, they get the job done a lot faster by telepathy.
Very true.
It's so much fun to be able to sit here and listen to their conversations and their imagery being shown to me so fast that trying to take it from that higher dimensional realm down to a Earth-based world is interesting to be able to relay it. And I noticed that there were times that there was no words for the conversations that Tolec would come up with the words. I say, yes, exactly, that's right. Because you can't, there are certain English words that are not available to be able to express what they're trying to tell me through our daily conversations.
Tolec and Adona, how often are you having conversations with these higher ups? How often are you guys with them?
All the time. Go ahead.
It's on a daily basis because, yeah. You see, I was born with nerve damage to both my ears. So it was easier for me to be able to hear them early on as a little girl. Of course, as a little girl, I didn't know that's what it's called, the telepathy. My grandmother passed away, whom I was very close to, at the age of 12. She came back to be my telepathic teacher. And we will have our normal everyday conversation. She would pop in and out and talk to me. But I didn't know that she was training me for my future mission with humanity. And it wasn't until I was 18 years old that she finally left because my mother released her. She told me one day, I finally let Mamma go. And when she did, Mamma was gone. She went into a higher realm to where she moved on to wherever she wants to go. And so at the age of 32, it came back because I had finished all of the, what you call preliminaries. In other words, learning about Earth life. And I had wrapped up all of my Earth life, and the sighting of a cigar-shaped craft in front of my house reopened all of that communication with the Star people, the Star families. And from then on, my whole life changed. So overnight, I started to get visions and dreams and premonitions and the whole nine yards of what the higher dimensions is all about, the type of life that we will live in the higher dimension compared to what we're familiar with today.
Tolec, from the chat room, we have a question that is, can you address from your perspective, but more so, I guess, from the Andromeda perspective, about negative entities or the species of any of those people who are just bad?
Okay, certainly. I'd like to dovetail what Adona just said.
Yeah, by all means.
With an aligned, suitable comparison, if you will. My people are people from the Tegeta star system. The contact people are family members of the Andromeda Council. They tell me that, like Adona, they were having contact with me as far early as age 5. But it wasn't until my move to Tucson, interestingly enough, correlating with the same time frame as Adona in her 30s, that I started to have unusual experiences like that. That experience where I drove down the highway and met the gentleman with the saucer, the commander of the Primary Andromeda Council Biosphere.
That's pretty amazing right there, Tolec. That's pretty amazing. You're woken up out of your sleep, or you happen to be up, and you hear this voice, and this voice says, hey, dude, come over here. Right. And most people would just dismiss that as a dream voice and say, ah. But you, obviously, had no choice in the matter. You had to follow it.
It was loud. Yeah, it was loud. It was loud, it was compelling, and just like I gave the analogy of we go to school, we've got some buddies that we've known for years and we stay in touch with, that was a similar kind of voice. I recognized his voice right away, and I'm like, oh, this is an old buddy of mine, I know who he is. So there was an inherent trust. And I didn't get the recall of those memories until I started having a whole bunch of things start happening in September of 2010. Which resulted in publishing the Andromeda Council website in May of 11, first week of May of 11. And now you have all the work that you see there. Keith, I'd like, so we can keep the flow going, I'd like you to ask me that question again so I can hear it fresh and address it.
About negative entities. What are the Andromedans or the people from the higher-ups, whatever civilization they may be or star system, but from the perspective of the people that you are working with, how do they view the negative beings here that are trying to take over humanity?
The beings that we've dealt directly with, we being one of the senior members of the Andromeda Council, which is the Procyon star system, people from planet Kaena, K-A-E-N-A. They have pretty advanced sonic high-frequency technology that they can attenuate from a low, deep vibration to a very high-pitch one. They use that technology in a variety of fashions to either clear out, shut down, blow up, destroy, shutter 15 plus major operational Draco and Hydra reptilian undersea bases and a couple of underground ones as well. And not just the people from the Procyon system. There were a couple of other star systems whereby they provided some additional help. There's, for anybody that's looked at this information, there's been years and years of control and manipulation by the human race. In fact, by these highly specialized marauders, if you will, called Draco and Hydra reptilians. And they've been leeching off, abusing, controlling human society for thousands of years. And this time frame of transition that we are in is exactly a post operational shutdown of the reptilians on this planet. There are only about 120 of them left. I want to say 70 or so pure reptilians and about another 50 plus reptilian human hybrids. And suffice it to say that there was an event that was going to happen in our future that would have been wholly catastrophic had the reptilians been allowed to control and manipulate Earth humans. So the people from the Andromeda Council stepped in and said, we've got to stop this abuse. That's the short version of the story.
When you say that there's 100 or so left, you mean completely left or left here in the quadrant of our local space causing nothing but havoc?
Yeah, about 120 left on planet Earth. There, keep in mind, there were high officials. There were reptilian high officials. There were also reptilian military officers, what we would consider to be colonels and generals, as well as engineers and foot soldiers, et cetera. Et cetera.
We're not speaking about they were just influenced by these others. These were actually incarnated reptilian beings hanging out in a meat suit.
These were reptilians and their families that were living in 15 major operational undersea bases on this planet for upwards of thousands of years. They are primarily higher dimensional beings to the point that they're 4.1 or 4.2. They're not 4.6, 4.7, 5.0, 5.1. We're talking the very bottom of the fourth dimensional scale. That's about the best way I can say it. And they're pretty much stuck in an evolutionary loop. They are what they are because they choose to be. They choose not to evolve any further.
Do you or Adona have any nightly excursions going back home, so to speak? And I don't mean going back home, just hanging out with them, but actually from a family unit perspective.
I've been to the Andromeda Council primary biosphere for a number of meetings. I hold the role of a contributor to something called the Joint Earth Council. I have a very good relationship with Ambassador Tonka, the gentleman who's the chairman of the council. The woman who's the chairwoman is also a diplomat, good friend of mine. Adona has her own experiences, and she can feel free to tell you about them, but we're always having contact with them. Adona?
Yes, same here. Basically, higher officials within the Andromeda Council have been to, as Tolec has also said, to a number of their meetings. Whatever there is important information going on, they'll let me know. And sometimes I pass it on to Tolec to let him know, and vice versa. So we basically are keeping up with the new information, new details that's coming in we seem to be getting information like 3 years ahead of schedule. That's what I've noticed. And when we first started talking about Andromeda Council, that has happened. And then it takes 3 years for the people to catch up to where it is happening. And they're all talking about it.
I'm sure you guys get downloads all the time. Like, what was that? I mean, can you tell when a download is happening, even though you haven't cognitively dissected the information yet? You know that when a download is happening? Are you aware of that?
Adona, go ahead.
Okay. Yes, I am aware of it. Because I get what they call high pitch frequency. I get called base frequency. I can tell when the ship comes to go, where they come in. Sometimes I'll have, my head feels like it's, I don't know, for the lack of a better word, it seems like it's getting larger, you know, and I can feel my head swell up. Basically, what they're doing is they're downloading the information into me. Now, for that, at that particular moment in time, I may not be aware of what type of information is given to me. It may have been for the future conversations that is upcoming, whether there's questions to be had or whether there is a need for humanity to know about this information. So, yes, I am aware of the downloads that comes in with the communications that they give to me.
Tolec?
Yeah, absolutely. It is something, and Adona can share her knowledge and illuminate more on this subject, but it is decidedly not channeling. It is a conscious downloading of auditory information, of as she said earlier, which is accurate, snapshot pictures, short movie clips. Sometimes it comes through where, if I have to do some writing, the information will come through that way. It's rare that it comes through like that, but some of it is very subtle. Like, I'll know some information when the only way you can tap into it is say, wow, this intuition is so strong that I know what I know. Now, the details, that's a different story. With the details, it's a matter of me asking a whole bunch of questions and getting a whole bunch of answers, which is why you see the kind of detail that you do on the website.
I really like that you differentiated between channeling and what's happening to you both, because I'm familiar with both. When this all started for me, I was a conscious channel, and I'm very much aware of the difference of vibration, the difference of the tone, the difference of the timbre, when it's not channel, when it's the other, when it's true contact, and it's almost as if something is being superimposed. No, that's sort of like channeling, but I do know the difference between the two. So if we slowly but surely, sadly, coming to the top of the hour, could you both, starting with Adona, would you give me your take, your visions, your premonitions on what's been told to you from your experience with these higher ups, if you would? What is the fate of humanity as current, from current day? That's a loaded question, and I didn't mean it that way. What I'm saying is, what is the prognosis they're giving us for humanity, and likely when?
Unfortunately, from what I have seen, Azar has told me. Azar is in charge of all the soul essence records. And she has said that there is a lot of confusion at the moment, right now, with humanity. The emotional, psychological bodies are still not in alignment yet. There are many people that chose not to awaken at this time, and it's okay because they have things to wrap up on, lessons to learn, things to accomplish. And then there are those who are awakened, very much so. She said that there are more people awakened today than they were 30 years ago, or even 5 years ago.
You know, I ask that question often of my guests who are in touch with higher energies. And the reason I ask that question is I'm very comfortable in my present moment. I'm very comfortable in my skin. I ask that question with the idea that one day, if I interview someone, they're going to say, ah, a decision has been made by the collective humanity, and now we're able to move forth. So I understand that in pretty much, Adona, you gave me the same answer everyone else has given before. And so I do understand that. We are at the top of the hour. Tolec and Adona, thank you so much for joining me here on Center of Light Radio for a very interesting show. I look forward to possibly having you on Center of Light Radio again in the future to learn more about what is happening with you both, as well as your connection to others who are truly compassionate and care about humanity. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard. Next week on Center of Light Radio, Derek Rydall, and we're going to be talking about emergence, the law of emergence. If you're not doing anything Thursday night, 8 p.m. Central Time, go to facebook.com/Keith Anthony Blanchard. You might have to refresh the page a couple of times to see the live stream I'm going to be doing. It's going to be about Take Me to Your Leader, ETs, and why they are here. Always feel free to go to centeroflightradio.com and check out the new website. Click that subscription form that you will find on the bottom of the opening page. It will give you access to my monthly newsletter installment program, as well as juicy information about Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life, my lifelong work. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host of Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time on Mondays. You can find me here. Always remember, when you have nothing to do late at night, you might as well be doing something. So breathe, 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 breathe until you find yourself through the ceiling of thought. And once you achieve that goal, you'll be hearing the profound, deafening silence of the cosmic life stream. Try it. Get back with me and let me know how you had success. Peace, love, and light. Ease into bliss. See you next week.